are leaving the chamber to do so as quickly and as quietly as possible. The next item of business is portfolio questions, and the first portfolio is rural affairs and islands. If a member wishes to request a supplementary question, please could I ask those that are leaving the chamber please to do so quickly and quietly. Any member wishing to ask a supplementary should press the request to speak buttons or put an RTS in the chat function if they're joining us online during the relevant question. And I call question number one, Rachel Hamilton.
To ask the Scottish Government what assessment it has made of the potential impact that proposed highly protected marine areas will have on the fishing industry.
Minister Mary McCallum.
Presiding Officer, on the 12th of December, I was delighted to announce our consultation on our proposed approach to designating at least 10% of Scotland's seas as highly protected marine areas. Together with publishing the consultation document, which sets out the background, process and rationale for the consultation, I also published a policy framework which sets out the Government's proposed definition of HPMAs, site selection guidelines, a partial islands community impact assessment, a partial BREEA, and an initial sustainability appraisal, which comprises two parts, an initial strategic environmental report, which assesses the environmental impact of the policy, and an initial socio-economic impact assessment, which identifies and assesses potential economic and social effects of the policy and proposes a methodology for carrying out site-specific SEIAs.
Rachel Hamilton.
I thank the Minister for that answer. And she will be aware that Scottish fishermen believe they are running out of space. The Scottish Government's HPMA proposals would take even more away from them. The Cabinet Secretary, Mary Goujon, joined me at the Scottish Fishermen's Federation reception in Parliament just last month, where she heard their concerns firsthand. On the basis of these concerns, will the Minister and possibly the Cabinet Secretary commit to postponing the proposed implementation of HPMAs until such a time that she can tell fishermen with all honesty that these proposals are not a threat to their livelihoods?
Minister.
Presiding Officer, I won't do that because the development of HPMAs marks the opportunity to make a step change in the protection of our precious marine environment. But what I will commit to the member, which is exactly what was committed in the suite of documents that we published on the 12th of December, is that we are at the very beginning of a process. Consultation and meaningful engagement has been a significant part of getting us to here, and it will continue to be so. And on that note, I would direct the member specifically to the stakeholder engagement document, which we published on the 12th of December.
Thank you, Minister. There are a number of supplementaries here. I would hope to get all of them in, but they'll need to be brief. Likewise, the responses. First, Kenneth Gibson.
Presiding Officer, no take zones from Lamlash Bay in my constituency to the Palau Islands have shown that fishers and the environment can both benefit from conservation. Does the Minister agree that it's crucial to ensure the sustainability of Scotland's commercial fishery and that highly protected marine areas will go a long way to achieving that goal, and can she advise on how she will engage with the fishing sector, ensuring it's not treated with the contempt shown by the Tories who made fishers' Brexit promises they haven't kept?
Minister.
Presiding Officer, HPMAs will deliver both protection and recovery of marine ecosystems such as blue carbon and critical fish habitats. And of course, this helps enhance our natural capital, which is the bedrock of sustainable marine industries. In collaboration with all sea users, the Scottish Government wants to ensure that the rich biological diversity of our seas is protected, enhanced and, where appropriate, restored, and in doing so to ensure that our marine ecosystems continue to provide economic, social and environmental benefits for the people of Scotland.
Colin Smith.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The Government have uniquely united fishers and environmental groups who both agree there's a lack of a clear spatial plan for Scotland's seas from the Government. But can the Minister tell us what she's doing to ensure that the highly protected marine areas are part of a coherent management plan for inshore fisheries as a whole that, among other things, specifically incentivise low-impact fishing?
Minister.
Presiding Officer, as I said, the HPMA policy and our pursuit of it is our opportunity to make a step change in marine protection. And just to remind the Chamber, it is that there will be 10% protection, highly protected areas, all extractive activity banned, and that in the in- and offshore space. And of course, that will complement our suite of marine protected areas, currently covering 37% of our seas, which by 2024 we will complete the management measures for, as well as work on priority marine features most at risk from bottom trawling. So HPMAs, together with completing the management measures within MPAs and the work on priority marine features, I think provides that holistic approach that Colin Smith is asking about.
Willie Rennie.
With a restriction on inshore fisheries recently announced by the government, why is it that scientific evidence will only be used to reduce fishing activity but not increase fishing activity? Why don't we follow the science wherever it takes us?
Minister.
Presiding officer, I don't recognise or agree with the characterisation of that the member sets out there. We will absolutely follow the science. We will absolutely consider the socio-economic impact of our actions. As I said to Rachel Hamilton, we are at the very beginning of what is undoubtedly going to be a complex process, but one nonetheless, which, if we can successfully pursue it, will mark a step change in the protection of our marine environment, which, of course, is important for our sustainable fishing industry.
Ariane Burgess.
I'm sure the Minister will be aware of research from England showing that marine protected areas which exclude the most destructive activities can boost fish populations by almost 400% and also boost the numbers of commercially important fish outside those MPAs. Does the Minister agree that highly protected marine areas will be essential in recovering fish stocks and supporting the development of a sustainable fishing industry which thrives within environmental limits?
Minister.
Presiding officer, I do agree with that. And as I said previously, these HPMAs, when in place, will deliver protection, they will deliver recovery of marine ecosystems, and of course they will enhance our natural capital. And all of that is the bedrock on which our sustainable marine industries can exist and exist successfully. And I'm committed, as part of the development of this policy, to meaningful ongoing engagement with the suite of stakeholders who have an interest in Scotland's marine space.
Thank you. Question number two, Fulton MacGregor.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what its most recent assessment is of the impact on Brexit, of Brexit, on Scotland's food and drink sector.
Cabinet Secretary.
The food and drink sector has borne the brunt of a hard Brexit pursued by the UK Government, and that's particularly through the loss of free trade and free movement. Many of Scotland's food industries are still suffering from lower exports to the EU, including a 48.8% fall in exports of fruit and vegetables and a 15% fall in exports of dairy and eggs in the first 9 months of 2022 compared to that same period in 2019. And that's not to mention the products that we now cannot export to the EU at all, such as chilled meat and an important industry to us in Scotland, are seed potatoes.
Fulton MacGregor.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that response. Research from the London School of Economics has suggested that household food bills have gone up by £210, mainly due to the extra checks and requirements on goods due to Brexit, which much of the cost passed on to customers. Scotland didn't vote for Brexit, as we all know, but people in Scotland continue to pay the price for Brexit, an act of deliberate Tory policy which is magnifying the cost of living crisis and the misery it is causing people. Does the Cabinet Secretary share my view that now Labour are decidedly pro-Brexit, only this Scottish Government can be trusted to stand up for the interests of our world-class food and drink sector?
Cabinet Secretary.
We have that clear evidence that Brexit is causing food bills to rocket, and because of that we are absolutely all affected. Now, we know that there are many factors that are influencing food inflation, but thanks to Brexit, the UK is facing one of the worst cost of living crises and suffering that more than what we've seen elsewhere. Now, the latest OECD and IMF forecasts show that the UK is set to have one of the highest overall inflation rates among G7 nations in 2022 and 2023. And all of that because we had a Brexit forced on us that we didn't vote for. We've been also dragged into trade deals that work against the interests of our own producers here in Scotland. And it's this government that has and will continue to stand up for our producers and wider food and drink sector in Scotland.
Thank you. There is a little bit of time. If members wish to ask a question, I'd encourage them to press the request to speak buttons. Question number three has been withdrawn. So question number four, Gillian Martin.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government how it's addressing any impact of the EU withdrawal agreement on the seed potato sector.
Minister.
Presiding Officer, Brexit, which of course the UK Government pursued during the pandemic, meant that at the stroke of a pen, Scotland's seed potato export market was lost. This, of course, was due to the UK Government's failure to secure an equivalence agreement for seed potatoes. And just to put that into context, Scotland previously exported around 20,000 tonnes annually to the EU and 2,000 to Northern Ireland. And this has been, the loss of this has resulted in the loss of £11 million annually. So it's vital that options continue to be explored to resolve this. We have been pursuing that since the disastrous Brexit agreement was reached. After a spate of ministerial changes over the summer, I most recently wrote to Mark Spencer. I'm awaiting a response to that, and I raised it also with Lord Bennion today.
Mr Carson, I've already said that if members wish to ask a question, they should press the request to speak buttons, and I will do my best to call them. Gillian Martin.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and thanks to the Minister. She's largely answered my question, but I can't believe that I've just heard a Tory shout out that this is the fault of our EU pals. This is the fault of the bad negotiators from the UK government in the Brexit deal. The seed potato sector, like a lot of Scotland's rural economy, has either been betrayed or totally ignored by the Brexit crusade of a Tory party who want to paint themselves as the champions of rural Scotland, despite the obvious harms they've imposed by an act of deliberate policy. Can I ask the Minister, she mentioned a letter, but what recent discussions of the Scottish Government had with the UK Government regarding this obligation that they have to fix a problem of their making and which continues to create severe challenges in my constituency, which has some of the best quality seed potato growers in the whole of Europe, who previously exported seed potatoes to the EU seamlessly?
Minister.
Thanks, Presiding Officer. And I know that this will be something which is a particular concern to Gillian Martin owing to her constituency. I mentioned that I had most recently written to Mark Spencer. I await a response to that and I will be chasing it very shortly. I also took the opportunity to raise the issue with Lord Bennion today when writing to him on a separate but related matter. The Cabinet Secretary and I have for months and longer in her case been raising these matters with the UK Government in our interministerial government meeting, sadly to no avail. Ultimately, this is as a result of Brexit, which Scotland didn't vote for, the hardest of possible Brexits being imposed on us by a UK government who refused to commit to dynamic alignment. And of course, it is Scottish industry who are suffering. Ultimately, this is a UK government who's been so willing to sell out Scottish industry, and that only in pursuit of their ideological Brexit.
Question number five, Carol Mochen.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what action it is taking to prepare for any potential surge in avian flu caused over this winter.
Cabinet Secretary.
The Scottish Government and its operational partners have a robust and regularly tested control strategy and contingency plans in place, and a proven track record in dealing effectively and rapidly with controlling outbreaks to prevent spread of infection onto other premises. We've responded quickly to the increasing risk of avian influenza from migratory wild birds through the introduction of an avian influenza prevention zone in October this year, which made it a legal requirement for all bird keepers to follow strict biosecurity measures to help protect their flocks, such as cleaning and disinfecting footwear and maintaining high standards of cleanliness.
Carol Mochen.
Thank you. I thank the Minister for the answer. We have seen particularly large avian flu outbreaks in the northeast of Scotland, as well as the infection of many coastal birds in my own region, south of Scotland, followed by a recent outbreak in Coehall in East Ayrshire. This has led to, quite rightly, strict biosecurity measures being introduced in November that are undoubtedly very necessary. Can I ask, however, if the Government has considered the financial implications of the new bird housing measures on farmers and what is being done to help them with this financial burden, given we know that the winter will likely make the flu infections more likely?
Cabinet Secretary.
Yes, that is obviously a significant concern given the period that we're at, and this is currently we're dealing with the worst outbreak that we've ever seen of avian influenza. And the member mentions biosecurity, and I think it is really important to emphasise that message again about just how important that high and strict levels of biosecurity are, because we know that if that is implemented, we can see a 44-fold reduction in risk of avian influenza compared to the housing of birds, which can provide a twofold reduction in risk. Now, we know that there are other issues there. I met recently with the president of the NFUS, as well as their poultry chair, to talk about some of those, particularly about biosecurity, what we can do to promote the messages around that, as well as some of the other challenges in finance and insurance that the industry is facing. But we are working closely with them to try and look for solutions.
And a number of supplementaries. First, Emma Harper.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Last month, the RAIN Committee heard from the Chief Veterinary Officer, which stated that flu viruses generally like cold and damp conditions, so they survive much better in the winter. And the Cabinet Secretary mentioned biosecurity. The evidence also pointed towards studies indicating that biosecurity can improve outcomes by a factor of 44, while housing the birds improved outcomes by a factor of 2, underlying the crucial role of biosecurity. So can I ask the Cabinet Secretary, what can we do as MSPs from all parties, what can we do to potentially take the message out to show that the message of biosecurity is really important and that the crucial role of biosecurity is something that we can focus on?
Cabinet Secretary.
I would just really like to thank the member for giving me the opportunity to emphasise this again, because we cannot emphasise enough just how important high biosecurity standards are when it comes to tackling this disease amongst poultry. And I think it's, and just to highlight as well, it's measures that include things such as cleansing and disinfecting of equipment, clothing, vehicles, preventing contact with wild birds, with vermin, by storing feed and bedding under cover, and ensuring that buildings are maintained to prevent ingress from flood water. I think we all do have a role as MSPs in trying to promote that message. Again, as I mentioned in my previous response when I met with the NFUS, that was part of what we discussed in relation to biosecurity, is how we can really try and promote that message as much as we possibly can. As a government, we try and do that through all the channels that we have available, but I would absolutely encourage and hope other MSPs would get on board with that and help share those messages so that everybody is aware of the measures that they can take to hopefully prevent this from spreading.
Thank you. And Alexander Burnett.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. There have been differences between the way Scotland has handled outbreaks of avian flu to the rest of the UK, particularly around housing orders. So can the Minister confirm how the Scottish Government has been working with the rest of the UK on this issue, and clarify what science or guidance the Scottish Chief Veterinary Officer is following to justify the differences in managing and preventing future outbreaks?
Cabinet Secretary.
I think it's important that when we're looking at these outbreaks, we need to remember we're not dealing with like-for-like situations. And of course, we take any evidence, and I rely on the expert advice and expertise of our Chief Veterinary Officer and our Animal Health team when it comes to that. And I think, as I've said to the member when he's asked questions about this previously, this is a situation that we continue to monitor and to keep under review. But again, I would emphasise that important biosecurity measure. When it comes to the engagement that we have across the UK, I think when it comes to animal health and combating disease like this, we do have strong working relationships. We need to in relation to that and how we tackle this. But again, it's important that we base any decisions such as housing, given the wider impact that would have on smaller keepers and the wider implications on animal welfare too, that this it's not a simple decision to take. But again, that's where I depend on the advice and expertise of our CVO, and it's a situation we continue to monitor.
And Beatrice Wishart, who joins us remotely.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. We've seen seabird populations decimated due to avian flu. Has the Scottish Government made the public fully aware of the actions they can take to mitigate the spread of avian flu? For example, if they're out walking over the festive period and come across sick or dead birds?
Cabinet Secretary.
Yes, we do try to do that as much as we possibly can. But again, I think following on from previous questions that I've had about communications and what MSPs can do as well, obviously I would welcome any help that members across Chamber can provide in sharing some of the messages as to how the public should handle these various situations, and really help us get out these messages for commercial keepers about the importance of biosecurity, as well as how to handle outbreaks or suspected cases. But that's information that I'm more than happy to circulate to all members so they have that information to hand.
Thank you. Question number 6 has been withdrawn. Question 7, Emma Roddick.
To ask the Scottish Government when it last engaged with the UK Government on the subject of EU replacement funding with respect to the Rural Affairs portfolio.
Cabinet Secretary.
We no longer have long-term certainty of funding as a result of Brexit, and unilateral choices imposed by the UK Government provide insufficient replacement for the EU budget. The UK Government promised a full replacement and collective engagement on future funding. Previous Secretaries of State have reaffirmed this commitment, but the UK Government so far has failed to deliver on that. EU replacement funding with respect to the Rural Affairs portfolio is an issue that Scottish Ministers have raised at the Environment, Food and Rural Affairs Interministerial Group meetings in the past, and we continue to make representation to the UK Government to fulfil their commitments.
Emma Roddick.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that answer. Scotland has been shortchanged across the board by the Tories and their Brexit obsession. As part of the EU, we could have accessed a multi-year allocation for marine funding of £62 million a year, while the UK Government has allocated only £14 million a year to Scotland. Reduced funding means reduced opportunity to realise benefits for coastal communities and businesses. So I wonder if the Cabinet Secretary shares my view that the obvious conclusion here is that the EU placed a higher value on coastal communities and businesses in places like my own region of the Highlands and Islands than that placed on them by our supposed partners in the Union.
Cabinet Secretary.
I fully share the member's view that coastal communities and businesses have been shortchanged through the Brexit process, and the UK Government haven't demonstrated the same commitment to those communities as we would have seen if we were still part of the EU, as has been highlighted by the figures that the member mentioned in her question. Now, not only with the hugely damaging impacts on small coastal communities of the barriers to trade that Brexit introduced, but we've also seen the loss of that multi-year funding, and that removes the opportunity to deliver that long-term planning, that certainty which impacts on trade and obviously just serves to stifle innovation. Additionally, the UK Government's approach to the Brexit problems that they've created through the establishing of the UK Seafood Fund and awarding themselves £100 million of funding simply causes duplication and confusion by undermining the devolution settlement and thereby making a bad situation 10 times worse.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. Question 8 has not been lodged. Therefore, that concludes portfolio questions on rural affairs and islands. Point of order, Finlay Carson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. On a point of order, I appreciate that the official report correction mechanism lasts up to 20 days, but today I seek to correct the official record on behalf of myself with respect to the 31st of May 2017, on behalf of former Conservative member Jamie McGregor, with respect to the 30th of September 2009 and 23rd of September 2010. On these dates, we inadvertently repeated statistics that we heard from Scottish Government ministers relating to Scotland's wind potential. We are now acutely aware that these statistics are incorrect. Presiding Officer, parliamentarians and members of the public were misled by SNP ministers and members into thinking this figure was true, and I'm appalled that I have inadvertently used incorrect figures on the record. We did not receive the briefing from officials that the figures were never sourced, unlike the SNP ministers who were told multiple times. Therefore, we of course seek to correct the record, and I certainly, Presiding Officer, will personally think twice before trusting anything that this SNP government ever says again. And while we are happy to correct the record, I note that numerous other offending SNP members are not as forthcoming. In fact, they still have to come to this chamber to repeat repeating the false claim that the figure was at one time true and is now just outdated. Presiding Officer, given this outstanding blight in the Parliament's official report, do you feel that the current correcting mechanisms are working? And what parliamentary process is available to members who wish to contribute to reforming these mechanisms to ensure MSPs and ministers are held to a higher standard than we have now?
Thank you, Mr. Carson. As you know, that's not a point of order. If there are things that you think require addressing in the standards order, standing orders, I would suggest that you write to the Standards Committee on that. It is not something on which I can offer any ruling. We need now move on to portfolio questions on health and social care. Again, any member wishing to ask a supplementary should press the request to speak button or place an RTS in the chat function if they're joining us online during the relevant question. And I call question number one, Douglas Lumsden.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what its response is to the letter received from the Grampian Local Medical Committee stating that general practice continues to be scapegoated as a profession in order to mask the failings of the Scottish Government. Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding officer, I have been very clear, explicitly clear, that any suggestion that GPs have not been seeing people face to face because they did not want to is false. It's a dangerous assertion. We know GP practices are working at capacity, and without expecting more work from our GPs, we do need to examine how access arrangements for patients can be improved, a matter which many members across this chamber have written to me about. To that end, I have set up a general practice access group. The group is establishing high-level core principles to support and enhance patients' experience of accessing the right care at the right place at the right time. We are, of course, committed to investing £170 million a year to help grow the multidisciplinary teams in GP practices and to further increasing the number of GPs in Scotland. We remain committed to delivering our target of 800 new GPs by 2027.
Douglas Lumsden. I'd like to thank the Cabinet Secretary for that answer, and it's good to hear that the numbers should be going up, because the latest figures show that, excluding trainees, the number of GPs fell in the last year, and the ones that remain are more likely to work part-time. And last week, the Royal College of GPs Deputy Chairwoman for Scotland said, within the current crisis of workforce shortages, intolerable workload and worryingly low morale and mental health, GPs are firefighting, and many worry they are no longer working in safe conditions and cannot continue. It is clear that the Cabinet Secretary has lost the dressing room. Will he now apologise to our GPs for the mess he has created and give our GPs the best Christmas present they could hope for and resign?
Brave.
Cabinet Secretary.
That's brave from the Conservative member, I have to say, given that, of course, our number of GPs in Scotland, if we exclude trainees, as he's asked me to do, is 83 per 100,000. That is higher than the 63 per 100,000 in Conservative-run England. So he may want to have a word of close with his colleagues. What I'd love to be able to do, presiding officers, invest even more within primary care. What, of course, is holding us back this financial year has been his government's economic mismanagement of the public finances. That has meant that my budget is worth £650 million less. And when it comes to scapegoating our healthcare workers, he is astonishingly brave to come up a day after his own colleague, Stephen Barclay, shamefully said this. He said that healthcare workers were consciously choosing to inflict harm on patients. So Douglas Lumsden and his Tory colleagues should hang their heads in shame, presiding officer.
OK, I've got a number of supplementaries. Again, I'll try and get through as many as possible, but they will need to be brief, as indeed Cabinet Secretary will the responses need to be. I call first Gillian Martin.
Thank you, presiding officer. I want the Cabinet Secretary's view on the content of the report out by the think tank Nuffield Trust, which warns that Britain's departure from the EU has worsened recruitment shortages in health and social care. While the NHS Scotland is clearly more restricted since Brexit in recruiting foreign staff to fill vacancies, what progress has been made to recruit more GPs to Scotland?
Cabinet Secretary.
Again, I can see Douglas Lumsden and the Tories groaning and moaning when Gillian Martin is asking such an important question, because there's no doubt at all that the folly of Brexit has caused significant damage, not just in the NHS, but importantly in social care as well. Don't believe me? Then feel free to listen to the contributions and the expertise of those in the NHS and indeed social care, and Gillian Martin has given a flavour of that. I've launched a recruitment drive to attract GPs to move to Scotland and particularly to rural, remote and island communities in Scotland, where we know there are some areas of challenge. We've funded the excellent ScotGem graduate entry programme with a GP emphasis since 2018, with 55 places increasing to 70 this year, as well as an additional 85 places on GP track courses. But between the Conservatives' folly of Brexit, Labour leader Keir Starmer insulting our overseas workers in the NHS, it's clear that the SNP are the only party in government that will not just welcome overseas workers to our NHS, but value them too.
They are going to have to be shorter answers from now on. Jackie Bailey.
General practice is not alone in being undervalued by this government. Yesterday we learnt that RCN members have overwhelmingly rejected the latest pay offer. And of course, nurses also work in GP surgeries, and they've faced years of real terms pay cuts that have pushed their colleagues out of the profession and put patient safety at risk. So will the Cabinet Secretary wake up to the fact that his workforce plan has failed, he's lost the confidence of NHS workers across Scotland, and will he give a commitment now that he will not impose a pay deal, but tomorrow will reopen negotiations.
Cabinet Secretary.
Astonishing, the lack of self-awareness, Presiding Officer, from Scottish Labour. Labour, of course, along with Conservative-run England, for the second week have strikes in the country where they are in government, where there are no strikes here in Scotland for a second week in a row. And she comes to this government and suggests that we have somehow lost the dressing room. Let me just tell her what, she may want to listen. She's of course speaking from a sedentary position, but Jackie Bailey may well want to listen, Presiding Officer, to what the BMA said about her colleague, Wes Streeting, who attacked NHS workers. She said, and I'll read, "It was not so long ago that Mr Streeting and the Labour Party were clapping healthcare workers for their contributions during the pandemic. So to hear them now accusing staff of a something-for-nothing culture and potentially supporting further real-terms pay cut will leave many staff extremely concerned." Now, Labour MP Diane Abbott responded by saying, "Inch by inch, Wes Streeting is trying to push for a private insurance-based NHS in all but name." It's a shame that Scottish Labour could not join their colleague Diane Abbott in calling out Wes Streeting's insulting remarks about healthcare workers.
Yeah.
Ms Bailey, Mr Lumsden, I've invited you to ask questions. You've asked questions and then you've sought to interrupt the Minister as he's trying to respond to them. Can we have a bit of respect, please? I now call Sandis Gulhani.
Dear, oh dear, victim or victim mode again. Cabinet Secretary telling nurses not to patronising. Brexit was a national referendum, something the SNP don't really seem to fully understand. Cabinet Secretary, 23 fewer qualified GPs than last year, a 9% drop in GP practices. Whole-time equivalent consultants are down 14.3% and double the number of consultant vacancies than you claim. What new plans do you have to help recruit GPs, because your flimsy recovery plan simply doesn't cut it?
Dr. Gulhani, imagine through the chair, Cabinet Secretary.
Imagine, Presiding Officer, as a Conservative member coming here to lecture us on how we should be treating NHS healthcare staff when your colleague in England said that you, as a healthcare worker, are consciously inflicting harm upon patients. You can't even stand up for yourself, let alone stand up for our healthcare workers. Have some self-respect, I would say to Sandesh Gulhani, and I would say that through the chair. Five actions that we're taking to help with GP recruitments. One, we have an active GP recruitment campaign underway. Secondly, in terms of recruitment, we have managed to have a record year when it comes to our GP specialist training fill rate. As part of the 2021-22 PFG, of course, we committed to increasing medical school places by 100 per annum. We are doing that. Fourth, the ScotGem programme I have already mentioned. And fifth, which is not in our gift, but maybe Sandesh Gulhani might be able to help with the minimal influence he has with the UK government, there have been calls across the UK government to ensure that there are changes in pensions that are disincentivising GPs. Perhaps he can use the minimal influence he has with the UK government to get some change in that respect.
Right, with apologies to the members, I haven't been able to get them the supplementaries. We're going to have to move on to question two, Martin Whitford.
I'm very grateful, Deputy Presiding Officer, to ask the Scottish Government what its position is on BMA Scotland's reported estimate that Scotland is approximately 1,000 short of the required number of whole-time equivalent GPs.
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, I would be keen to see the evidence base from the BMA for this. We are, of course, making good progress, as I've already said, against our commitment to increase the number of GPs by 800 by the end of 2027. The number of GPs has increased by almost 300 since 2017, when that target was first announced. So we have a record 5,209 GPs working in Scotland. The increase in GP headcount will help deliver an increase in GP whole-time equivalent capacity too. The number of GPs required and the capacity, of course, depends on a number of factors, including the size and shape of the team around them. While GP headcount is how we measure our commitment, both sets of data are important, and as I say, we'll continue to work with the BMA on this.
Martin Whitfield.
I'm very grateful to the Cabinet Secretary for that response. In recent weeks, I've met with several GPs across East Lothian, and they expressed concern about the increasing pressures they face in their practice and the impact of the government's cuts on their ability to meet capacity. I would like to ask the Cabinet Secretary whether, first, he will take seriously what these clinicians are saying, but secondly, they talk about a practice which is patient-orientated with continuity of care. This has numerous benefits, not least of all, a shortening in time that GPs need to read in about the patient who comes to see them. Does the Cabinet Secretary support this model, and how is he supporting it with the interaction between GP practices and the health boards?
Cabinet Secretary.
I can thank Martin Whitfield for a really helpful follow-up question. Yes, of course I'm aware of the pressures that his colleagues as GPs in East Lothian have raised with him. Barely a week or a month will go past where I'm not interacting with GPs on a regular basis, and I'll perhaps pay a visit to East Lothian to the GP practices there. But what I would say is that some of the issues he's raised around patient, not just access, but time with patients, is exactly why I've set up the patient the GP access group. And GPs are part of that group as well as, of course, I want a patient representative to be part of that group too, because nobody is doubting how hard GPs work. I've said as much to GPs, and I will say it again in this chamber, GPs are working unbelievably hard. But I do think that the hybrid model, face-to-face, telephone and video consultation, is a model that should be embedded and should continue. But I get representations from all across the chamber. In fact, I got it from when I was in committee with Monica Lennon, who was there yesterday, made the point that some people are still struggling to see their GPs face-to-face. And that is true right across the country. So anything we can do to improve that while working with GPs is good for, of course, the confidence people have in general practice, but good for people in the public too.
Again, a lot of interest. I want to get the supplementaries in, but again, brief supplementaries and brief responses. First, Kenneth Gibson.
Yeah, thank you very much, Presiding Officer. Cabinet Secretary, what impact has George Osborne's pension changes had on GP numbers over the last decade, given how many have felt compelled to retire as a direct result of them?
As briefly as possible, Cabinet Secretary.
Well, while I don't have the exact numbers in front of me, I would say to Kenny Gibson, it is one of the key issues that is raised with me by GPs right up and down the country. Regardless of where they are in the country, they've been asking for pension changes. Now, there has been some changes, in fairness to the UK government, some changes that have been made. But as Kenny Gibson rightly has said, for many GPs, that has come too little, too late. So there are some further changes the UK government could make. I understand they're consulting on them. I would urge them to do the right thing, because recruitment of GPs is, of course, important, but no point filling up a leaky bucket. Retention is going to be really important, and pension changes should be able to help us with that.
Willie Rennie.
The problem is that the government were in denial for many, many years about the number of GPs. Many in this chamber were warning the Scottish Government they needed to up the recruitment, but they failed to act at the time. So the crisis that we've got in primary care is solely down to the Scottish Government being asleep at the wheel. So what new measures is the Cabinet Secretary going to take? Because there are far too many patients in my constituency that can't even get through on the phone, let alone get an appointment.
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, I don't agree with his characterisation, and of course the figures would not bear that out, where Scotland, if I exclude trainees, has 83 per 100,000, and that is vastly higher than other parts of the UK, not by a small margin, but quite a significant margin. That's a demonstration of the record of our recruitment. I've given a list of five things that we're already doing, but on top of that, of course, as I've mentioned already, the challenges with access, there's no doubt numbers of GPs will play a part in that, I would say to Willie Rennie, but there are things that can be done to improve access to GPs right now, hence why I've set up the GP Access Group. GPs will be part of that, patient representatives will be part of that, and of course, as that group meets and gives me recommendations, I'll make sure Willie Rennie and the rest of Parliament are kept updated.
And very, very briefly, Emma Harper.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I will be brief. It's on GPs. Earlier this month, the BMA's GP committee noted that Labour was guilty of demonising GPs who are trying their best to deliver care. So the quick question is, what steps are being taken by the Scottish Government to engage constructively with our health trade unions to ensure that being a GP remains an attractive career choice with a manageable workload?
As briefly as possible, Cabinet.
Well, but I take this issue very seriously, Presiding Officer, in relation to our relationship with health trade unions. It's why, of course, again, for the second week in a row, we're the only part of the country where there are not strikes. Now, I don't take that for granted. That's because of meaningful negotiations and discussions, both with the trade unions, and I hope it's recognised meaningful discussions with the government too. So I'll continue that engagement. I'll make sure my door is always open to meaningful dialogue. And certainly, you won't have me or this government ever standing up to demonise our health workers in the way I'm sad to say we've seen, certainly from the Conservative Party and from West Streeting and the Labour Party too.
Question number three, Kenneth Gibbs.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what the impact of air pollution is on mental health.
Minister Kevin Stewart.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The relationship between air quality and health is complex, and it is currently uncertain what impact air pollution has on the mental health of individuals. There is an emerging body of research indicating an association between air pollution and an increased risk of mental illness. There is also some evidence to suggest that air pollution is associated with altered brain function and structure, the implications of which are not yet clear. It is important, Presiding Officer, to point out that air pollution targets are being met across the vast majority of Scotland, though pollution hotspots are still present in some cities and town centres. Work with local authorities and other partners is underway to address these hotspots as quickly as possible, such as the introduction of low emission zones in our four largest cities. And the Scottish Government takes the issue of air pollution very seriously, and the Government is in regular contact with SEPA, the independent regulator, concerning SEPA's regulatory role in relation to industrial sites in Scotland.
Kenneth Gibson.
I thank the Minister for that helpful reply. Researchers at Washington DC's American University studied the impact of fine atmospheric particulate matter concentrations on suicide levels over a 7-year period. Conclusive results showed a direct link between depression, suicide and atmospheric pollution, even when the air is polluted for a single day. This is probably because an inflammatory response in the brain to particulates disrupts the pathways that regulate mood. Given these findings, what further steps will Scottish ministers take to tackle air pollution?
Minister.
Thank you for that question, and I will take a look at that research from the American University in Washington DC. The Cleaner Air for Scotland 2 strategy published in July of 21 sets out how the Scottish Government with partners will continue to deliver on air quality improvements over the next 5 years. It contains over 80 actions across health, placemaking, transport, public engagement and industrial emissions. Levels of the main air pollutants have declined significantly in Scotland over the last 3 decades, and this has been achieved through tighter regulation, improved fuel quality, cleaner vehicles, and an increased focus on sustainable transports. All of that has happened, but nonetheless, our vision and our aspiration is for Scotland to have the cleanest air in Europe.
Very brief supplementary, Paul.
I'm very grateful, Deputy Presiding Officer. Given the body of evidence that is growing, would the Minister agree with me that this is a public health emergency and that we do need to take a public health approach, as has been advocated in Greater Manchester by Labour Mayor Andy Bowen under the Marmot Review? And would the Minister take a look at that along with Marie Todd?
Briefly as possible, Minister.
As I said in my initial answer, there is an emerging body of research. We'll continue to monitor that and act accordingly.
Thank you. Question 4 is not lodged. Question 5, Evelyn Tweed.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what help it is providing to suicide support services, including SAMH and its recently launched campaign, Ask Them About Suicide, ahead of the festive season.
Minister.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. In September, the Scottish Government and COSLA published a new suicide prevention strategy, Creating Hope Together. The strategy aims to reduce the number of suicide deaths in Scotland whilst tackling the inequalities which contribute to suicide and is supported by the Programme for Government commitment to double suicide prevention annual funding to £2.8 million by 25-26. The new 10-year strategy and first action plan will build on the strong partnership model which underpinned the delivery of the previous action plan, Every Life Matters. This partnership model involves third sector mental health partners leading delivery of key elements of Scottish Government-funded activity. And over the last 4 years, that includes government funding for SAMH to develop the social movement, United to Prevent Suicide, and to deliver a range of national suicide prevention campaigns, including FC United to Prevent Suicide and Better Tomorrow. We greatly value the role and the contribution of all third sector partners working to prevent suicide across Scotland, both nationally and locally, and look forward to extending our partnership approach as we deliver the new strategy.
Evelyn Tweed.
I thank the Minister for that answer. SAMH's campaign encourages everyone to simply ask the question, are you thinking about suicide? If they are concerned about a loved one, would the Minister encourage anyone concerned about a loved one to ask the difficult yet very simple question, are you thinking about suicide, to allow them to seek further support?
Minister.
Presiding Officer, I agree with Evelyn Tweed. We should all be alert to suicide in our communities and to ask anyone who is struggling with their mental health that question. Are you thinking about suicide? By asking this crucial question, we show care and compassion, which can help people talk more openly about their feelings. And it also creates a space to discuss reaching out for further support and advice.
Thank you. Brief supplementary, Carol Mochan.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. In the absence of Jim Fairley's debate on male suicide this week, I thought it important that we do recognise that 75% of people who die by suicide in 2020-21 were male, and a high proportion of those male were young and from a more deprived area. Every death by suicide is a tragedy, a life lost, a family grieving, a loved one. It is abundantly clear that we need a strategy that does not only promise but also delivers. Therefore, I ask the Minister how the Scottish Government will work with organisations with close links to large groups of young men, such as football clubs in my own area, Kilmarnock Football Club and Ayr United in South Ayrshire, in my region, to ensure together that we are continuing to make progress towards fully removing the stigma from talking about mental health and suicide, particularly amongst that young male group.
I recognise the importance of the issue, but we are going to have shorter, particularly supplementary questions and responses. Minister.
I'll be very quick. I hope that we'll have the opportunity to debate Mr Fairley's motion. I think it is a very important one. As I've said to the Chamber before, football clubs have a real big role to play here. And I've been to St Mirren in recent times on a Suicide Prevention Day, which was very worthwhile for the community there. And, of course, there's changing rooms, extra time, which we run in association with clubs and SAMH.
Question number six, Richard Lynn.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. Can I remind members of my register of interests to ask the Scottish Government whether it will provide an update on the actions taken in Forth Valley Royal Hospital following its escalation to stage 4 of the NHS Scotland National Performance Framework for Governance, Leadership and Culture?
Cabinet Secretary.
I met with Christy McLaughlin, Chair of the Assurance Board, alongside with the external support team earlier this week. While the Assurance Board is providing direct monitoring and support to Forth Valley, the onus is, of course, on the NHS Board to commit to and deliver on improvement. It's important that we allow NHS Forth Valley the opportunity to deliver, of course, immediate and tangible improvements over the coming weeks. And in my statement to Parliament last month, I committed to writing to members before the end of the calendar year. I've signed off that response, so if it hasn't come to members yet, it certainly will come later today.
Richard Lennon.
Can I thank the Cabinet Secretary for his answer? The escalation to stage 4 is long overdue, but this escalation is focused at a very senior level. That may be where the change needs to begin, but what about support for workers on the front line? These failures have had a massive impact on them, leading not simply to low morale, but to burnout, to anxiety and to depression. Cabinet Secretary, on your watch, these health workers are on their knees, with many leaving the service altogether. I've been told that just last weekend, one nurse at the Forth Valley Royal Hospital was left on her own with responsibility for 37 patients. 37. That's over 4 times more than the recommended safe limit. So when is action finally going to be taken by this government, not just to give assurance to the leadership, but to give assurance to the patients and to give assurance and support to the poor bloody infantry working on the front line this Christmas?
Cabinet Secretary.
Can I thank Richard Leonard for his question? Can I make it clear that the assurance process and the improvement plan associated with the escalation framework is not just for the management or indeed for the board, but we expect to see and we will monitor that improvement and, of course, ensure those improvements percolate from the top right the way through to those who are very much on the front line. I won't go into detail because we don't have time around some of the challenges that are facing health systems right across the UK. One of the things we can do, of course, to try to ensure that we take care of the well-being of our staff is to make sure they are paid well. And that's why I'll continue to engage meaningfully with our trade unions. That's why we have put that record pay deal on the table. The very last thing, Presiding Officer, I will say is that I did commit to meeting with the whistleblowing champion at Forth Valley. I do think there's a strong role to play for whistleblowing right across our NHS. I've not been able to meet with the whistleblowing champion yet, but intend to do that early in the new year.
Right, we're at 25 minutes. We've got two other questions on the order paper. I do want to get supplementaries in. These portfolio questions are important, but the questions will need to be short and the answers shorter too. Stephen Kerr.
The Cabinet Secretary must be familiar that there's a very critical report that lays bare a culture of bullying and intimidation in NHS Forth Valley. And that's admitted by the senior management, and they're now in special measures. There must be a question of competence and confidence. So why has no one resigned or been sacked? Why does the Cabinet Secretary continue to have such confidence in those who've managed to make such a fine mess of things?
Cabinet Secretary.
What I would say to Stephen Kerr is the escalation framework is there for a reason. It is important that we're able to, of course, escalate Forth Valley in the circumstances given, but I think it would be reasonable to say to the board, and I think any reasonable person would understand this, that we expect an improvement plan. We'll hold you account to that improvement plan. And if we don't see that improvement, of course, there is another level of escalation. So I would implore Stephen Kerr to look at the improvement plan. We'll have everything published on a website, so it's transparent, it's open, it's there for people to see. And then let's make sure that we are collectively holding Forth Valley to account. Ultimately, my responsibility, of course, and I can guarantee him that I will be doing that.
Question 7, Faisal Chow.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government, what specific measures are being taken to support social care workers during the cost of living crisis?
Minister Kevin.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. There are more than 1,200 social care providers across Scotland, with local authorities responsible for providing or commissioning services. Local authorities and health and social care partnerships will want to ensure that they provide appropriate support to social care workers. In addition, the Scottish Government are committed to improving fair work practices across the social care sector. We have increased pay over the last year from £9.50 per hour to £10.50 per hour, and will further increase the rate to the real living wage next year and continue to work with stakeholders to secure improved terms and conditions for those working, including improved sick pay and maternity and paternity pay.
Faisal Chowdhury.
I would like to thank the Minister for that answer. But would he agree with me that this winter's situation facing social care workers, who have for too long been underpaid and undervalued in our society, is another example of why they cannot afford to wait for a national care service before they see real improvement in their working conditions?
Minister.
And that's why we're not waiting for the National Care Service to be up and running to improve pay and conditions. As I pointed out, we will raise pay again to the real living wage, which is not the case in either England or Wales, where social care workers are on the minimum wage. Beyond that, this week we published, along with COSLA, our statement of intent to help improve conditions. And one of the ones which I want to see improved very quickly indeed is maternity pay, because I believe that it is extremely unfair in this day and age that there are women out there who are not entitled to maternity pay. So that is one of many things that we'll be doing before we get to National Care Service.
And question 8, John Mason.
Thank you. To ask the Scottish Government whether it will provide an update on the new North East Hub Health and Care Centre in Parkhead, Glasgow.
Construction started on the 28th of March 2022. The construction programme is on schedule. The hub is planned to be complete in two phases, July 2024 for the main building and August 2025 for the car park. Following handover of the first phase, there will be an 8-week equipping and transition period before patients move to the new hub.
John Mason.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for the reply, and it's encouraging to actually see the building just round the corner from my office going up fairly rapidly. Can the Cabinet Secretary say, once the hub is operational, if this will mean that fewer patients have to travel to Stob Hill from the east end of Glasgow? Because travelling to Stob Hill is not easy by public transport.
Briefly as possible, Cabinet Secretary.
I have to say I share John Mason's excitement about the project, and anybody who hasn't seen the concept behind the Parkhead hub, I would encourage them to do so. The short answer to his question is yes, it should result in reduction of patients travelling to Stob Hill. The hub will have a space for outpatient clinics and the delivery of enhanced treatment and care tailored to the community. So that should result in fewer trips to Stob Hill.
Thank you. That concludes those portfolio questions. There will be a brief pause before we move to the next portfolio.
Point of order, Martin Whitfield.
I'm very grateful, Deputy Presiding Officer, and I seek your guidance on the courtesy that members should show where, if a question is asked in a portfolio, they should stay in the chamber until the end of that portfolio section before leaving.
The member is absolutely entirely correct, as befits the convener of the relevant committee. Members should extend that courtesy to all other members, the ministers, and I'm not entirely sure who the member is referring to, but... that is indeed the correct position. Thank you for that helpful clarification. I think we're all ready to go. So the next portfolio is social justice, housing and local government. Again, if a member wishes to request a supplementary, they should press the request to speak button during the relevant question or enter the letters RTS in the chat function online. I call question number one, Stephanie Callaghan. I call question number one, Stephanie.
Sorry, Presiding Officer, I don't actually have anything here. There's been a wee bit of confusion with my sheets. I do apologise.
Ms Cullen, I think you are question one, but it may be that you are wishing to withdraw your question. I'm not entirely sure.
Sorry. My apologies. There's been a bit of confusion. I don't have my question with you. I have it now. To ask the Scottish Government what its response is to the Child Poverty Action Group report, The Cost of a Child in Scotland in 2022 update.
Thank you. Minister Christina McKelvey.
Thank you. Yes, I welcome the report's recognition that our policies are making a major contribution to families. We have allocated almost £3 billion this financial year to help mitigate the cost crisis. Over £1 billion of this support is only available in Scotland, including the Scottish Child Payment, which has been expanded to eligible 6 to 15-year-olds and increased to £25 per child per week. And our budget confirms our commitment to tackling child poverty. The report rightly notes the harmful impact of UK government decisions, and we will continue to urge the UK government to tackle the cost crisis on the scale that is required.
Stephanie Callaghan.
I thank the Minister for that response. Certainly, what continuing discussions are we having with the UK government then around getting the support to children across the UK and encouraging them to follow Scotland's lead?
Minister.
So I recognise the point that Stephanie Callaghan's making there, and a recent Scottish Government analysis highlighted that if key Westminster welfare reforms were reversed, this could put £780 million into the pockets of Scottish households and lift 70,000, including 30,000 children, out of poverty in 2023-2024. The Scottish Government stands by its call to the UK Government to increase universal credit to £25 per week and extend it to the means-tested legacy benefits, end the benefit cap and the two-child limit, and maybe while they're at it, the rate clause, and provide additional support with fewer bills and match our ambitions in tackling child poverty by introducing an equivalent to our game-changing Scottish Child Payment.
I call question number two, Claire Adamson.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what guidance is in place for local authorities commissioning domestic abuse services.
Minister Christina McKelvey.
Thanks again, Presiding Officer. The Commission of Domestic Abuse Services is a matter for local authorities. However, the Scottish Government strongly encourages local authorities to utilise the joint COSLA and Scottish Women's Aid's guidance on good practice in commissioning specialist domestic abuse services. Through Delivering Equally Safe, we fund the Improvement Service and Safe Lives to work with local violence against women partnerships to build and grow the capacity and capability of local services across Scotland.
Claire Adamson.
Thank you for the Minister for her answer. Myself and other colleagues consistently raised concerns when North Lanarkshire Council tendered its domestic abuse services contract, in my opinion, contrary to the COSLA approved guidance. But despite the Council's stated commitment to continue partnership working, Women's Aid groups continue to provide more specialist support than the new Council service, but without local authority financial support. My office has been made aware of a number of vulnerable women who have fallen through the cracks of the Council service and are now being supported by Women's Aid. I sought to raise these concerns face-to-face with the leader of North Lanarkshire Council, but he has declined to meet with me on this issue. Can I ask the Minister if she will meet with me and representatives from Motherwell and District Women's Aid so that we can assure that survivors of domestic abuse are afforded agency and choice in special support provision and refuge, and that no woman and child is left behind in this process?
Minister.
Thanks for that question. We want to ensure that funding provided works most effectively to improve outcomes for those using violence against women and girls services across Scotland. That is why we commissioned an independent strategic review of funding to tackle violence against women and girls, which will report in mid-2023. Any services that are commissioned should be done through a trauma-informed process, and we are aware of the funding situation in North Lanarkshire regarding services to tackle violence against women and girls. The Scottish Government cannot interfere with local authority autonomy and procurement procedures, but we do continue to encourage local authorities to follow the procedures and guidance that are in place in the Joint COSLA and Scottish Women Aid guidance that I mentioned earlier. And yes, I would be more than happy to meet with the member and anyone else who are concerned about these services.
Supplementary, Pam Gozo.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Western Bartonshire in my region recorded the second highest number of domestic abuse incidents per 10,000 population in Scotland in 2021 to 2022. This number sits at around 161 incidents per 10,000 population. This is despite Western Bartonshire Council increasing their spend on domestic abuse services by more than 10% in the past 5 years. Can I ask the Minister, how is the Scottish Government supporting local authorities such as Western Bartonshire, which suffer the highest rate of domestic abuse, to increase their capacity to support victims of domestic abuse and tackle this appalling crime?
Minister.
Yeah, I recognise the points that Pam Gozo has made there, and our Delivering Equally Safe Fund is providing £19 million per year to support 121 projects from 112 organisations that focus on early intervention, prevention, as well as support services. Of this, £14 million is being provided to the Women's Aid Network in Scotland over 2 years, supporting secondary prevention of domestic abuse across Scotland through support services and informing policy. And over this period, 21 to 23, the Delivering Equally Safe Fund is providing £2 million to support the rollout of Safe and Together, a model that is that it's training across 11 local authorities area. I'm not sure if Western Bartonshire is one of them, but I will find out. And a further £1 million to be spent towards the CEDA project, which is a group model that works for children who have experienced domestic abuse. £209,000 of funding is going to Safe Lives to develop our multi-agency risk assessment conferencing for high-risk victim survivors, and I would commend that work to Pam Gozo for her interest and can give her more information if she seeks that. Additionally, we fund a domestic abuse and forced marriage helpline, and through our victim-centred approach fund, we support Edinburgh Women's Aid, Fife Women's Aid, Western Isles Women's Aid, Angus Women's Aid and Dumbarton District Women's Aid, totalling £1.3 million over 3 years, but happy to speak to Pam Gozo or meet with her to discuss further.
And supplementary, Beatrice Wishart, who's joining us online.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. How will the Scottish Government ensure in any guidance or discussions it has with local authorities commissioning domestic abuse services that local situations within authorities is taken into account so that services, particularly in island and rural areas, have local knowledge and understanding of those island and rural communities?
Minister.
Yeah, thanks, Beatrice Wishart, for that question. She will be aware of the independent review that Leslie Irvine is currently working through, and she's looking at all aspects across Scotland, including our rural and island communities. And her recommendation, her report and recommendations will be published in summer 2023, and that will allow us to see what the funding landscape is like across the whole of Scotland. Additionally, I'm working very closely with the new chair of the COSLA Wellbeing Board, Councillor Maureen Chalmers. We had a development just a few weeks ago with all of the services across Scotland to develop our new approach to Equally Safe. And that will not be about chucking Equally Safe out starting with something new. It's looking at what works and where the gaps are, and some of that provision across rural services is where we're focusing some of that work, as well as looking at primary prevention. And happy again to meet with Beatrice Wishart and maybe talk to you in the summer about some of the recommendations that are coming from the Leslie Irvine Review too.
Question number 3, Murdo Fraser.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government when it plans to review the legislation on licensing of short-term let accommodation in light of the reported unintended consequences for existing providers that have emerged.
Minister Patrick Harvey.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The licensing scheme seeks to ensure that short-term lets are safe and well managed. We don't believe that there will be adverse consequences. We're working with local authorities to resolve any implementation concerns raised since the scheme went live in October. And on 7th of December, we announced plans to extend the transition period that existing hosts have to apply for a licence by 6 months, recognising the economic circumstances of the cost crisis. The Cabinet Secretary for Social Justice, Housing and Local Government is therefore considering the timing of the review and will update Parliament in due course.
Murdo Fraser.
Can I thank the Minister for his response? But I can give him an example of an unintended adverse consequence right now, because my constituents, the Homelands Trust in Fife, a small charity based in London Links, run facilities providing respite breaks for people with disabilities, life-limiting conditions, under unpaid carers in 4 purpose-built, suitably adapted self-catering properties. Due to the rising demand for their services, they are building 5 new accessible lodges with 34 bed spaces for those with disabilities, which are due to be completed early next year. But they cannot apply for a licence to operate these until they are actually completed. And then Fife Council have up to 9 months to issue that licence, which means they may not be able to take any guests into that accommodation potentially for another year. So they've incurred the costs, but they cannot generate any income from these properties potentially for 9 months after they were opened. So that is, I assume, an unintended consequence of this legislation that's been introduced. So how is the Scottish Government going to address what is a very real problem for a small charity trying to help people with very serious issues?
Minister.
Well, if the member wants to write either to me or to the Cabinet Secretary about any specific local instance, I'm sure we'll be able to look into the specifics of that situation and get back to him. But it's very clear that the licensing scheme itself is intended to address very real consequences of an unregulated market, which have involved issues from antisocial behaviour to a lack of safety, either for the community or indeed for those who use short-term lets. And responsible operators have absolutely nothing to worry about, because they are already managing to achieve those high standards. Those high standards which we should all want to raise the sector up to, while we continue to work with local authorities around their wider powers on planning. But again, if the member is unhappy, I would urge him to write to myself or the Cabinet Secretary about a specific local situation.
Supplementary, Willie Rennie.
Also in Fife, the Council is suggesting that it won't be possible to utilise the control area powers until 2024, after the licensing provisions are fully in place. Does the Minister believe that it's necessary to wait this long, and did the Minister envisage that control areas couldn't be delivered until after the licence scheme was in place?
Minister.
Well, I think as these measures were being developed, there was significant debate across Parliament, and I think a growing understanding that these are separate provisions. The licensing scheme is around principally safety and standards, whereas the control areas, the planning powers that local authorities have more to do with provision and ensuring that properties are not lost as homes for people, instead being siphoned off into effectively running a hotel business. So I think it's understandable that these schemes do operate separately, are used for different purposes, and I'm sure that all local authorities are seeking to strike the right balance about how they may use these powers in future.
Question number 4 is not lodged. Question number 5, Paul Sweeney.
Presiding Officer, to ask the Scottish Government what discussions it has had with the Scottish Housing Regulator regarding the future of community housing associations.
Minister Patrick Harvey.
We do, of course, have regular engagement with the independent Scottish Housing Regulator on how it contributes to supporting the delivery of our national outcomes. We very much value the diversity of the housing association sector in Scotland. One of the key strengths of community housing associations is their unique position in delivering local, democratically accountable housing and services. And we want a Scotland in which everyone can play a full part in society, with empowered communities able to shape their individual and collective futures. Community housing associations have been doing this for decades in many parts of Scotland and will continue to do so.
Paul Sweeney.
Presiding Officer, I thank the Minister for that response. The Minister may not be aware, but Reid Vale Housing Association in Denniston in Glasgow, one of the oldest community housing associations in Scotland, is currently under threat of being railroaded into a merger against the wishes of residents and the wider local community, with members over 40 years standing being hounded off the management committee and co-opted members brought into gerrymander decisions that are critical to its future. To date, there has been utter intransigence on the part of the housing regulator, and the residents have lost all confidence in the process and the willingness of the regulator to help them. So will the Minister look at the case of Reid Vale with a view to pausing any tender process for a transfer of undertakings, and will he commit to working with me cross-party and residents and fellow Glasgow parliamentarians to ensure that this vital community housing association remains rooted in its local community?
Minister.
I thank Paul Sweeney for his very sincere concern about this issue, and I'm sure that I, indeed, again, or the Cabinet Secretary will be happy to engage with him on this. The housing regulator, of course, is an independent regulator of social landlords, and its statutory objective is to protect the interests of service users and tenants, and it uses its powers to monitor, assess, report and intervene where appropriate. I'm aware of the situation in relation to Reid Vale, and the management committee has commissioned options on its future and has agreed to the recommendation to seek expressions of interest from organisations that wish to become a transfer partner. But it's important to recognise that proposed transfer will not proceed unless it is supported by tenants in an independent ballot. The community, therefore, has the final say. And once again, I look forward to further opportunities to engage with Mr Sweeney on this issue.
Question number 6, Alexander Burnett.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what its response is to reported warnings from COSLA that local government job losses are inevitable and that services will have to be reduced.
Minister Ben McPherson.
Sir, nobody underestimates the challenges facing public services, but the Scottish Government has increased local government funding by over £1 billion this year, and the 23-24 local government settlement will provide a further increase of over £570 million compared with the budget in 22-23. This includes an extra £39.4 million to support day-to-day services in Aberdeenshire. We are building flexibility and autonomy into how budgets can be spent, but a more fundamental shift is required, as the Deputy First Minister has said, and he has invited Council leaders to work with the Scottish Government and other partners to design our services around the needs and interests of the people and communities of Scotland. That is how we will deliver sustainable public services in partnership.
Alexander Burnett.
Can I thank the Minister for that answer, but he may want to review it, because the Fraser of Allender Institute said that funding allocated to local government in last week's budget was equal to a 4.9% real-term decrease based on spending last year, while the Institute for Fiscal Studies has accused the Scottish Government of overstating the spending increases by comparing spending next year to last year's budget and not taking into account in-year rises. In Aberdeenshire, this is going to mean non-statutory function of the councillors at risk, from school crossing patrollers to the maintenance of our bridges. Does the Cabinet Secretary, does the Minister agree with these statements?
Minister.
The Member will be aware that the Scottish Government's budget has been impacted by the inflationary pressures caused by the previous Chancellor's mini-budget statement in the autumn, by a very detrimental effect of £1.7 billion. And in these very challenging circumstances, the most challenging budget settlement since devolution, we are going to be providing in the budget for 23-24 a local government settlement of £13.2 billion, which, as I've already stated, is an increase of over £570 million since the Budget Act 22-23. And, of course, this is additional spending for local government, but also spending on how we work together on shared priorities, and it's important to keep those shared priorities in mind.
Question number 7, Monica Lennon.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what action it is taking to ensure that children and young people in families experiencing poverty are supported throughout the Christmas holiday period.
Minister Ben McPherson.
The Scottish Government is taking a number of actions, and this includes this month's bridging payment, which will be paid to around 145,000 children and doubled to £260. This means eligible families will receive up to £650 this year in bridging payments. We are also providing £21.75 million to local authorities in 22-23 to support families eligible for free school meals during school holidays. Tackling child poverty is a national mission, and we are using the powers and resources available to us to support families. This includes delivery of our transformative Scottish Child Payment to all eligible children under 16, which was increased to £25 per week from the 14th of November.
Monica Lennon.
I welcome the Minister's response. I know that he will agree with me that no child or young person should experience holiday hunger at Christmas or lack access to nutritious food due to poverty at any time of year. Can the Minister therefore reassure me that the Scottish Government is satisfied that local authorities and third sector organisations have access to all the resources they might need to ensure that no child or young person will experience holiday hunger over the festive period? And if I can suggest a New Year resolution, will the Government redouble its efforts to expand universal free school meals to pupils in primary 6 and 7 and in secondary schools in 2023?
Minister.
Thank Monica Lennon for that important question, and of course the Government is applied along with its partners and local authorities in supporting families and young people and households who need it across this Christmas period. And that also extends into the next financial year, where the budget continues to invest £22 million to provide meals during the school holidays to children who need them most, and of course also invests an additional £16 million of resource and £80 million of capital to fund the expansion of free school meals for all primary 6 and 7 pupils in receipt of the Scottish Child Payment as the next step in fulfilling the commitment to universal provision in primary schools. This is, of course, on top of the £442 million that has been allocated for the Scottish Child Payment. And may I just take this opportunity, actually, to pay tribute to Monica Lennon as one of the most active MSPs in this chamber for promoting devolved Scottish benefits, and of course many of her constituents and many of all our constituents will benefit from that extra provision from the Scottish Child Payment.
A supplementary, Natalie Dond.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I welcome Scottish Government interventions like the Scottish Child Payment, which are completely unique to Scotland. However, given the fiscal constraints of devolution and the damaging impact of Tory welfare policies, is it not the case that it's simply not possible to go as far as we would like to eradicate child poverty here in Scotland while the key levers are held at Westminster?
Minister.
Unfortunately, the impact of UK government policies, as was stated earlier by Christina McKelvey, is hampering our efforts to tackle child poverty. In addition to the damage already caused by UK welfare policies over several years, the Chancellor plans to bring a further 600,000 people who are already working into a sanctions regime, and we know that sanctions regime for universal credit doesn't work. Whilst their policies are pushing people into hardship, unfortunately, this Scottish Government takes all the actions we can to tackle child poverty, and our budget prioritises the Scottish Child Payment, which I've already mentioned, of course increased to £25 per week, but also an investment of £428 million to uprate all Scottish devolved benefits.
And question number 8, Miles Briggs.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what discussions the Social Justice Secretary has had with ministerial colleagues regarding the support available to families experiencing poverty, including as a result of rising energy costs, where a seriously ill child relies on life-sustaining equipment at home.
Minister Ben McPherson.
Every week, ministers discuss how we are assisting and can assist the people of Scotland during this cost of living crisis. As I said in response to Mr Briggs at the Social Justice Committee last week, no seriously ill person should have to worry about their finances at such a difficult time. And that is why some patients using hemodialysis or oxygen equipment at home are already accessing financial support. And we will continue to work with health boards to ensure as far as possible that those requiring support are able to access it. Also, our child winter heating assistance benefit, which is only available in Scotland and is automatically paid to families of around 25,000 children and young people, has recently been paid out to help people with energy bills. And as I said, recipients have begun to receive this payment in recent weeks of £214.10.
Miles Briggs.
Thank the Minister for that answer, and obviously I've been raising these issues with the Minister on a number of occasions. We know the additional costs which families are facing, especially families who are caring for people with long-term terminal conditions. I welcome some of the work the Minister's outlined on this. It is clear, though, we need to see more and collectively go further on this. So would the Minister agree, and he's already agreed to meet with me in the new year, to look towards where government can develop additional support around care at home or hospital at home to help meet these costs? Because it's clear that for the 5,000 families with children with a life-limiting condition, we need to see an additional support package around energy. And is that something, on a cross-party basis, he'll look to take forward in the new year?
Minister.
Mr Briggs is aware of what I said to him last week, and that I recognise his work on raising awareness of these issues of households that are managing a situation where they are caring for somebody who's either ill or disabled or terminally ill. And he has proposed on several occasions, along with stakeholders, a number of different initiatives in the current benefit system, and also as we continue to develop new benefits like Scottish Carers Assistance, for example. However, of course, as well as the merit in these proposals and assessing them, we also need to consider the financial circumstances, and I look forward to engaging with Mr Briggs on what is both doable and affordable in the years ahead.
And brief supplementary, please, Paul McLennan.
Thank you. Given energy pricing and the majority of welfare powers are reserved to the UK Government, what more does the Cabinet Secretary think the UK Government should be doing to provide support to vulnerable families?
Minister.
We have called on the UK Government to target additional support for those who are already struggling on several occasions, including a permanent £25 uplift in universal credit, which should also be extended to means-tested legacy benefits, and an end, of course, to the benefit cap and two-child limit should take place. We will continue to press the UK Government to undertake these changes and use all the levers at its disposal to tackle this emergency at the scale it's required. These include access to borrowing, providing benefits and support to households, VAT on fuel, taxation on windfall profits, and regulation of the energy market. And we hope the UK Government will do more in the new year ahead.
Thank you, Minister. That concludes portfolio questions on social justice, housing and local government. There will be a very short pause to allow frontbench teams to change position before the statement. Thank you.